Chapter 8, Code Du Hall. Felix and Karl boarded a mail coach leaving Glasgow, headed for Liverpool. The coach was going the impressive speed of 10 miles an hour. It was a fast trip out of Scotland. Felix deep inside knew that the trip would be the last time of truly feeling the freedom of wandering and sketching for the fun of such things. It was now time to head back to the hustle of English society, at least for Klingman. Karl had business back in London, so he bid Felix farewell at Liverpool. Felix was saddened, but had made his decision to venture through the Lake District, see Wales, and make it to Ireland. After a day's worth of traveling, Felix arrived at an inn in the Welsh city of Llangollen. Upon entering the tavern and taking a seat, the atmosphere didn't suit him well. Whether it was Karl's absence or the musicians playing their harps, his impressions on Wales was hindered. He penned to his family, August 1829, 4,000 devils take all national music. Here I am in Wales, and heaven help. A harper sits in the hall of every reputable tavern, incessantly playing so-called folk melodies. That is to say, dreadful, vulgar, and out-of-tune trash with a hurdy-gurdy going on at the same time. It has given me a toothache already. Anyone who, like myself, can't stand Beethoven's national songs ought to come to Wales and hear them bellowed by rough nasal voices into the crudest accompaniment and then try to keep his temper. As I write, a fellow in the hall is playing this. He scribbled the godforsaken melody on the paper, then wrote in exclamation, "It is making me so angry, I can't go on." Felix wrapped the letter to send. He stayed seated while at the tavern to try the Welsh beer. It tasted decent enough, a satisfying drink with a meal of rarebit and barrel lager. It lifted his mood some. He especially enjoyed the barrel lager that was served on toast. He wasn't sure what the green sauce-like spread was made of, but he found it appetizing. He saw the name of it on the menu. It tasted fishy. As the innkeeper came by, he asked, "What is the barrel lager made of? It's quite good." "That's lava bread. It's made of seaweed," the innkeeper answered. "A very common dish to forage here in Wales, especially by the sea." Felix looked back at the dark green food. He wasn't expecting it to be seaweed, not knowing such a thing was edible. Seaweed was tasty. Since the music of Wales didn't favor Felix, the food made up for it. After eating a square meal, Felix looked at some maps of Britain. He knew not much about the way to Ireland, so he asked the innkeeper as he came by again, "Sir, might I heed some advice from you? I am wondering a way to Ireland. Do you know the best route?" "Ireland is a good beauty to see, but I must say and regret that a trip there may be more of a hash than it's worth. The season is yielding quite ill-fated weather. A voyage over the crossing would not be a pleasurable one. Getting there would be a challenge as the rain is to be falling most of the week." "All right, thank you. Diolchyn fawr." He tried his best to speak the local language. The innkeeper smiled at his politeness. Felix scratched his Ireland idea. He had enough seasickness in the past few weeks. He was done with it. Now he needed to decide what to do next. He wanted to leave Llangollen before the rain. A carriage would be bound to get stuck in a muddy mess. He then remembered the Taylor family he met in London. They had a home in Wales. It was in the country near the village of Rhydymoon. The village wasn't far from Llangollen. As the weather remained fine at the moment, he took a carriage. The ride was decently beautiful. Within a few hours, the carriage turned at a driveway. It led into a most charming landscape of hills and green. At the end of the finely graveled road was Code Du Hall, a large home the Taylor family rented. As the carriage neared the home, passing the well-groomed yard, Felix saw two of the Taylor daughters in the gardens. Closer to the house, in a nearby meadow, their mother was there, riding a donkey as it grazed peacefully among the wild roses. Felix had the coachman stop and jumped out to greet Mrs. Taylor. She dismantled from the burrow and shook his hand upon meeting. "Oh, such a surprise from London. Dear Mendelssohn, what has brought you here?" "I've come from a tour of Scotland. My companion, Herr Klingman, had to return to the city, but I decided to keep furthering through Britain. I had hoped to make it to Ireland, but alas, the weather will soon be in the season of rain and rough voyages, I am to hear." Felix looked at the donkey. He grabbed an apple he happened to have in his bag and fed it to the burrow. Mrs. Taylor mentioned, "I wouldn't be going anywhere too far in the next few days or so. The mud is terrible. That is why I'm wondering if I may stay a week at Coed du Hall, if I may ask John. John and his eldest son are away for the next day, so the decision must lie with me. She smiled as the donkey began to nip at Felix's bag, wanting another tidbit. Mrs. Taylor then giggled. I suppose you should stay, the donkey insists. In the meantime, for a room to be prepared, there is a nice inn at Rydamund to stay at. But please, before you leave for the day, take a walk with the girls. They, soulfully, will be very much obliged. I saw Anne and Honora in the gardens, but pray tell me, where is Susan? She is out in the woods writing somewhere. May you also, if you would be so kind as to stay for tea? Of course, Felix replied with a smile. He left Mrs. Taylor, then went to where he had seen Anne and Honora. Though he enjoyed their company much, it was really Susan he wanted to see. In London, when meeting, he couldn't help but take note of her beauty. When the girls noticed Felix coming, they cheered in excitement upon the visitor, running to him. Anne couldn't contain her joy. Oh, it's so well to see you here. I did not know you'd be coming. Yeah, I've been making my way around. I'm to stay for a walk and tea. Any amount of your stay is a privilege. Anne gracefully smelled the daisies she had picked. Felix went on to explain. I'm to stay in the village nearby for a night or two, so a guest room may be prepared. I'll be staying here a week. Really? Both girls exchanged glances. As they continued to chat in the garden, one of the Taylor sons rushed to the group. He was the youngest son, in his mid-adolescence. Anne seemed a bit annoyed at his intrusion on the conversation. She asked him, Peter, why are you running about so frantically? Have the woods caught on fire? No, I heard from Mother that Mr. Mendelssohn came to visit, and you were going for a walk. Please, may I join? He begged. I suppose, Anne sighed. Her tone caused Peter to look to Felix. If you don't mind, sir. Of course you can. I didn't get to speak with you much in London, Felix inquired. He figured Anne and Peter were just having a normal brother-sister quarrel. He understood as he had older and younger siblings. Honora didn't mind any of it. Anne quickly took Felix's arm as to escort him the way to the walking paths in the woods. Peter and Honora followed beside. Felix sensed that Anne had wanted the walk to be only he and her. Though he did care about Anne and loved her company, he didn't think it well to give her the wrong impression. The group walked through the calmness of the trees, and every now and again a stag would be seen grazing the mulberry bushes. When they neared a heap of stone, Felix went towards it in wonder. It looked like it used to be a structure of some sort. He stepped onto one of the stones. What is this? It's part of an old mine, hence why the stones are dusted with bits of coal, Anne explained. Do be careful. The entrance of the mine is on the other side, a few of those stones. It would be a horrid fall. Her tone expressed worry as Felix climbed another large rock to look over it. Felix assured her, I am just going to glance at it. I have not seen a real coal mine before. I am curious. When my father returns, he will show you a real one that's functioning and safe. Anne then commented, as you should know, curiosity killed the cat. All right, Felix sighed, coming back down. As they walked along some more, they heard horse hooves clamping against the dirt path. Then a little ways down, Felix felt a slight wave of breath taken aback. A beautiful gray horse came their way. Its rider wore the most beautiful blue outfit for a leisurely trot about. Her happiness in doing so shone as gold. It was Susan. Felix looked to her in complete awe. Anne noticed and took his arm as to escort him again. Susan rode up to them and looked enthralled to see Felix. She dismantled from her horse to greet him. She held out her hand and Felix took it and casually kissed it as to greet an elegant lady. Anne glanced at Felix as he had not welcomed her in the same fashion. Such a pleasure to meet a familiar face of London, Susan smiled, blushing. Anne glared at her younger sister. Felix began blushing as well, but he did his best to hide the fact of youthful admiration. He stated, I am happy to know such a family takes a home here in this side of Britain. Susan and Felix met gazes for a few moments in silence. Peter and Honora were chasing frogs and toads jumping about. Anne couldn't handle such awkwardness anymore and nudged Felix. Let us all go back to the house. 'Tis near time for tea. Susan and Felix shook out of their moment, and everyone headed their way back to Code Dew. Susan rode her horse as Felix walked beside it, holding the reins to guide it in their pace. When they returned to Code Dew Hall, Susan took her horse back to the stables. The others went inside. Felix turned about the main hall. It was like a breath of fresh air, open and clean. Anne mentioned, "My cousins are staying here a few days yet. They are from Ireland." "How nice," Felix commented. Everyone went to the parlor, where a casual tea had been set. Sitting on a couch were two girls in their early adolescence. They glanced up from whispering upon seeing a new guest. Anne introduced Felix. The two girls greeted him, then went back to their murmurs and whispers, laughing and eyeing Felix as if he had done something funny. The hour of tea made for some of the calmest moments. Susan sat next to Felix on an elegant parlor couch. Anne, of course, sat on the other side of him, striking up conversation whenever Susan did. Felix enjoyed both their company. Mrs. Taylor listened to them talk in awe. She began to have hope in Felix's stay that the enthusiastic young man would become even more acquainted with her daughters. After the teapots were empty, Felix made his leave to the suggested inn at the village. It was a two-story brick building, very pleasant. Everything there was spotless. After getting a room, he unpacked some luggage to get reorganized. The rooms were very peaceful as the evening came about. Once he blew out the candle to sleep, the atmosphere gave some of the most relaxed rest. The next day, Felix ate breakfast at the inn's tavern. He tried some of the other traditional Welsh dishes he hadn't yet. They were good, but he, of course, got a serving of the barlawr to get his fill of it. It tasted even fresher as the village was closer to the sea than Llangollen. He spent his time inside as the rain fell lightly outside. A harpist decided to sing a morning tune in the hopes to cheer the weather, to Felix's dismay. Felix went back to his room and sat at the little stationery desk. He sorted through some manuscripts of music and began on some compositions. He made an outline of a short operetta for the upcoming silver wedding anniversary of his parents. At the same time, he sketched an organ work in case Fanny would be having a wedding. He made use of the day, writing, then going down to the tavern for lunch and dinner. It felt good to catch up on work as well as rest from sickening travel. Though Wales would not be as adventurous as Scotland, it was a perfect way of winding down from the rough journey in the Highlands. When the 27th of August came, Felix returned to Code Dew Hall. His guest room had been prepared and so very nice. He fell in love with the bright, calm decor and fresh air flowing through the windows. The cousins from Ireland had left, leaving a room for him. After unpacking some, he headed to the main hall to look around the quaint home. He was welcomed by John, as he had returned home from traveling. His son that had gone with him returned to his own country home. The eldest sons had families of their own and worked with John in the mining company. "I had not realized you were staying with us," John was surprised upon seeing Felix. Felix felt like an intruder and explained, "I came by a day or so ago and spoke with Mrs. Taylor. I figured she would write to you." "No matter," John assured. "I'm perfectly happy that you are here. It was just unexpected. Why don't you come and have Demetos with me?" "Sure," Felix followed him to the sitting room. A maid brought in a tray of small coffee cups. A few sandwiches had been made as well. John and Felix were the only ones enjoying the small coffee. The rest of the family were outside, tending to their gardens. John spoke of many varying subjects as to learn more about Felix. They had met in London at Mr. Chapel's home, but this was much more casual. It gave Felix a sense of home. As the hour of Demetos neared its end, John noticed Felix eyeing the piano in the windowed area of the room. John encouraged him. "You must be itching to play the piano. I imagine in traveling it's hard to find a decent instrument. Please go play some." Straightway, Felix went to the beautiful grand. He touched a few keys, and upon hearing it in tune, he sat at the bench. A fantasful improvisation echoed. John set his cup down and walked towards the windows that surrounded the piano. He gazed outside into the gardens as the tune carried. Felix smiled as he thought of the green leaves and all of the different flowers blooming. Each kind sparked his hearing mind. Upon finishing the little tune, John commented, "I had no idea how delicate the piano could sound. It fits so well with the nature and scenes. Nature happens to inspire much of my music. Something about it gives way to song, Felix turned to him. John then changed the subject. I do assure that in 2 days' time, my family and friends will be heading to one of the mines a few miles out. We are having a dinner, something festive for the workers. You are welcome to join. I'd love to, Felix became excited at such. I heard that you have an adventurous spirit. I'll let you see inside of a working coal mine when we go, John added. Felix stood from the piano in all joy. From the first day of Wales to the present, his thoughts of the land were becoming more favorable. The rest of the day, Felix wandered the home, had dinner with the family, and composed in his room. The night was calm with the sounds of crickets. He peacefully penned up his operetta by candlelight. He titled it Sun and Stranger. For the organ piece, he wrote in another section. There was no say yet from Fanny about the wedding. Hours went by into the cool midnight. At midnight, Felix set down his quill and blew out the candle. The bed was soft and one of the coziest. Through the open shutters, the songs of toads and crickets put Felix to sleep. Everything felt perfect. He couldn't imagine leaving such a home. The next morning at the table, a hearty breakfast of Welsh cakes were presented. Tea and coffee were served as well. John read a newspaper and Mrs. Taylor and the girls spoke about their gardens. John's son, Peter, watched Felix pen some music. After breakfast, everyone went to do their own things. Felix went to the piano to improvise and test out his operetta. Klingman had written verses and storylines to base the music. Though Felix still had a negative outlook on opera, he decided to keep his work within the family gatherings. After using up some ideas, he looked up from the music and gazed out the windows. The three Taylor daughters were in view, running through the wildflowers and grasses. Each one had their own distinct way thither through the lush grass and admiring each blossom. He placed his hands on the keys and played his feelings. The daughters' personalities began to influence his improvisations. So much so he began to sketch three unique caprices based on each of them. For Anne, her favorite flowers, red roses and carnations, were captured by the sounds of an allegro vivace in A major. The softness gave the feeling of their wafting scent. Honora loved the vines with the trumpet-shaped flowers, so we thought up something to mimic the blossoms, which was no easy task. In an E minor scherzo, he put a crisp fanfare-like phrase at the beginning. For Susan, her caprice was especially pretty. It depicted a meandering rivulet, flowing free in the woods. Felix figured he could finish the pieces, then give to them upon his leave. That evening, dinner consisted of lamb chops and roasted carrots, tossed in a specially homemade maple bourbon glaze. Honey-roasted chopped almonds and scallions were used as the spice to top it off. The aroma filled the house. The sight of this meal could make anyone's mouth water. The family took their seating at the large table. Honora and Peter sat together, and Mr. and Mrs. Taylor took the end seats. Felix was squeezed between Anne and Susan. Everyone got a plateful of the delicious meal. Its taste was the most divine. As Felix bit a mouthful of roasted carrots, Susan begged to him, "After dinner, may you teach me some piano? Father heard you play and said it was beautiful. I've heard many good musicians." "I've been learning piano as well. May I join?" Anne butted in. Felix was still chewing, holding his answer. He didn't want to rush as to not waste the flavor of such food. The sisters were rather looking to him with overcrowding eagerness. He finally swallowed. "Of course." Instantly, their eyes brightened up. Susan then spoke of the pieces she enjoyed. Felix was enthusiastic as she mentioned Mozart and Haydn. Mrs. Taylor smiled as the two spoke in all youthful manners. Anne butted in when she could and looked towards Susan with a daring glance. Susan began to catch on to her sister's intentions. Felix turned to Anne as he began to feel her stares as well. Anne smiled at him in all kindness. Dessert was then served. It was blackberry Monmouth pudding, which was another traditional Welsh dish. It was a creamy whipped pie of pudding, blackberries, and fluffy cream on top. When it was sliced, the layers of it were a beautiful purple and white. Upon tasting it, Felix couldn't help but ask, "Is there a recipe I can take home with me? As well as that bourbon glaze, my family back in Berlin must try this." "Oh, I can certainly get it written down," Mrs. Taylor had an exciting tone. The maid left to go write a copy of it. She came back with some note cards and handed them to Felix. He glanced them over and pocketed them. After the pudding was devoured, Felix headed for the piano with Anne and Susan. The girls stood around the instrument as he sat on the bench. They listened to him play. There was no music on the stand, but he recalled a folk melody and did his own version of it. Susan couldn't believe their own piano could have such etiquette. When Felix finished with a few flutters of notes, he asked, "Do you have any sheet music?" "Yes," Anne went to a cabinet and picked out a piece. Felix looked at it. "It's a duet. Schubert, in fact. Fantasy in F minor," he smiled, playing some of the upper melody. Anne sat next to him. "I know how to play this one." She placed her hands on the keys. Felix nodded and he played the lower voicing. Though the music sounded superb, Felix noticed that the piece she chose had a lot of phrases where their hands were close together. At one point in the piece, their hands crossed. Anne at times made a mistake, and her hand bumped into his. Susan found a Mozart duet. When the Schubert piece finished, she discreetly shooed Anne away to sit. Felix looked at the Mozart piece, and they began playing. Susan had more skill at the keys, yet she needed to hold her fingers better. After finishing the piece, Felix suggested, "Be sure to place your fingers correctly and don't let them slouch on the keys. You'll want to keep the strength of them up and keep your joints loose for a smoother attack." He showed her his stance. She watched and then copied his manner. In an instant, her playing improved. She turned to him. "Your playing is by far the prettiest. I'll have to call you the chief piano player. I believe it's all about how you go about playing. You are lucky to have such a fine English piano." Felix fluttered some notes. They continued on with much music and lessons. The next day, the family packed up a large lunch for some festivities. They were going to be having a picnic outside of the mines with the workers. Everyone took part in preparing it. Felix helped carry baskets as the family and him hiked to a mine a few miles away. The weather was thankfully sunny and calm. The beauty of the land was breathtaking. When they arrived at the picnic site, a group of locals were already gathered in the grasses, drinking wine and brandy. A big wood-paneled shed with a few surrounding wood structures stood in the middle of the grassy yard. Inside the building was where the deep coal mine was contained. Excitement stirred all the more amongst the gatherers when the Taylor family and Felix brought food. The occasion gave the utmost joy. Straightway, the meal was served and drinks were drank. Felix enjoyed every bit of it. He loved being involved in the true state of the local culture. As in London, the people began to think of him as one of their own, only his speech giving him up. After eating and drinking a while, John told Felix, "You must come and see inside the mine. Though we dig for coal, there are beautiful rocks and things." "Sure," Felix slightly slurred as he finished a shot of brandy. Most everyone was having their fair share of drink. John led Felix to the entrance of the large wooden building. Inside looked even bigger than out. It contained a mechanism which was a pulley system to lower a lift into the deep opening in the earth. John lit a lantern and gave it to Felix. He then used the pulley system to get the lift to the surface. The platform was only suited for one person to stand on. John gestured Felix to get on it. Felix was unsure of it as the lift wobbled a while, stepping on it. John assured him, "It's safe, I assure." Felix took his word for it and clung to one of the ropes. John then lowered it down. As the lift reached a few body lengths down, if Felix hadn't had the lamp, it would have been pitch black except for the small bit of light from the entrance. The lift continued on, lower and lower. A few interesting rock formations were here and there. The naturalness of the Earth's crust began to inspire Felix's hearing mind, as it was a new experience. The sound of the grand orchestra came while seeing the vastness and depth of such a structure. At 500 feet below ground, the lift stopped. Felix paused in the moment. His surroundings were dead silence and near darkness. He looked up. The entrance was barely visible. It was a mere dot of light in the deep hole. Heart-wrenching minutes passed as the lift stayed put. He tugged at the ropes and called out to John, "Pull me back out." He hoped his voice carried up. It echoed through the shaft. It didn't move. The lamp on low fuel dimmed more and more. Soon, his surroundings were pure darkness. As he thought he'd been abandoned, the lift was pulled back towards the surface. The second it reached the normal ground, Felix stepped off the lift and sat on the ground, trying to calm his nerves. John went to him in worry. Felix, are you all right? It was just a mine. It was so dark. You left me in there until the lamp burnt out. His eyes were still adjusting from being in such darkness to natural light. John snickered a bit. Well, I had to make sure you got the full experience of it. Felix stood back up and shook himself out of his nervous state. He and John then rejoined the party outside. They were still drinking and speeches were being given in toast. Felix met many miners, learning about their lives and interests. Yet the evening went on with mostly drink. Felix resorted much to the company of Anne and Susan, flirting and speaking poetically in his best English. Anne, of course, loved every word of admiration, though his talk was intended for Susan. The picnic went on until late evening. The morning sun shone through the window, feeling like a slap in the face. Felix groggily opened his eyes to see a maid opening the curtain in his guest room. He had somehow returned to bed last night. As he was in a sleepy state of confusion, the maid walked to the desk, studying the manuscript of composition sitting out. After noticing Felix awake, she left to tend to other work. A sharp headache came over him. He didn't think he had drank that much. He snoozed in bed a while, then made himself get up. It was late morning, but there was still enough time for breakfast. He dressed into something decent and headed for the dining room. Mrs. Taylor was in the sitting room and saw Felix passing by. She called for him. He turned around and entered, keeping composure. "Sit, please," said she. He listened and took a spot on the couch across from her. They both sat in silence as she watched Felix closely, as if studying him. He sat naturally, trying to ignore his throbbing head. She finally spoke up. "You appear in a bit of a disorderly state." "It's just a small headache," he mentioned. She then joked, "I would be surprised if you didn't. You got into quite a bit of the brandy last night." "A bit of a bad headache, actually." He rubbed his forehead. Mrs. Taylor stood and gestured to Felix. "Here, come to the kitchen with me. I've something that may help." Felix eagerly followed. Once they got to the kitchen, Mrs. Taylor opened a cabinet and grabbed a glass jar of some chocolate milk. She poured some into a drinking glass and handed it to Felix. "Chocolate milk is quite a useful remedy in the case of a hangover." Felix drank it, and within a few minutes, the sugar from it helped ease his symptoms. The milk calmed his nausea. He then asked Mrs. Taylor, as she gave him more, "How did I get back to my room? I don't remember coming back." "John and Peter walked you back as you started sleeping at the picnic table. You didn't cause a ruckus or anything. You just got sleepy." "Oh, good. I was worried. I assure you, I am truly no lush." He sipped some more chocolate. Mrs. Taylor assured, "It's easy to get caught up with those miners' way of fun. I would stick with chocolate for today. In fact, chocolate is becoming the popular drink in London. Anyways, the girls went to go sketching this morning and wanted you to join. But you were still sleeping. I imagine they are still out drawing, if you want to catch up with them." "I would like to." He finished some more milk, then went back to the guest room to grab some sketch paper. Outside, he found the girls in the garden, closest to the woods, drawing and laughing. When Felix came to them, they excitedly shared their art. Felix began his own sketches of some roses and the trees. The girls were surprised that he had such skill. Susan teased, "Aren't you just talented at every aspect? Look how perfect that flower is. It's a spitting image." "I assure you, this is not top-grade art. I'm only an amateur." Felix erased half of it to retry, and tried to stop all of his erasing. "You're ruining it by doing that. It was so good the first time." "Hey, quick, draw that girl walking over there." Honora pointed to at a girl holding a basket. She was collecting raspberries in the neighboring grassland. Felix sketched and began bursting into laughter. Anne tried to get a peek of it, but Felix kept it hidden. Susan leaned in to see, but he wouldn't let anyone get a glimpse as it was in progress. Yet became so winded with laughter, he fell back in the grass and dropped the sketch paper. Anne grabbed it and laughed hard at its appearance. The others looked in curiosity. Anne commented, "All right, you aren't skilled at everything. What is this? It's hardly a person. Her face looks like that of a camel." "I can't sketch people, right? It's my weakest aspect in drawing." Felix still laid in the grass in laughter. Susan teased, We should probably hide the sketch in case that girl comes over. She folded it and pocketed it. Once they calmed from their antics, they continued drawing the hills and forests. As the day went on, they spent it all outside. They ate lunch sitting in Mrs. Taylor's garden. Two of the Taylor sons joined them. One was Peter. The other was a year or so older than him. His name was Anthony. After they finished lunch, they decided to go out into the woods in the early evening. They wanted to build a fort. Each of them helped by gathering branches and fallen logs. Felix helped with much zeal, dragging the largest tree scraps he could find. There were many fir trees in these woods. The air was hot on the summer day, tiring the group, but they were determined to make a good structure. They started putting together their findings in an open area in Susan's garden. By the time the sun began to set, their little house of branches was finished. Anne then said, "All we need now is a fire." The boys gathered more wood and built one in the thicket of the trees. When it was lit, they all sat around, telling stories and laughing. Susan began to sigh, "If only we had some music on this perfect evening." "Could anyone get something to play on?" Felix asked. "We are near the gardener's cottage. He has a fiddle," Anthony recollected. Honora encouraged, "You must go get it." The other girls agreed. Peter and Anthony ran off to seek out this fiddle. When they came back, Felix looked at the instrument in amusement. The strings were broken, but one. Felix took it and tuned the string the best he could. Upon moving the bow across it, he gave way to fits of laughter. It had the most wretched screech. His laugh spread to everyone else. Then a wave of seriousness bestowed him, and he managed to gently glide the bow over one string, forming a single-voiced melody in all decency. The soft, ruddy phrasing went on until the dark of the night forced them to return to the house. The next few days at Côte du Hall were filled with more happy memories. Even if the rain trapped them inside, the house would echo with music from the piano. The true and heartfelt expressed feelings of Felix's nature in the day were known by the way he improvised and played. Eventually the day came when Felix had to return to London. On his day of leave, when it was still morning, the girls gathered around the piano, listening to him play one last time. It was new music to them. After finishing three pieces, he grabbed the sheet music from his folder and handed the pieces that he made for each of them. They were baffled and enthralled. It was the best farewell gift they could wish for. After the long, saddening ride of leaving Wales behind, Felix returned to his flat in London. The city was busy as ever. He felt ever so heartwarmed to find a pile of letters from home. The first one he opened was a wedding invitation. It was for Fanny and Wilhelm. A note was folded with it. Felix rushed to read it. "My dearest brother, I suggest you leave London as soon as possible. Do not forget the music I asked of you. Father is currently in the Netherlands. You could meet him there, and we shall welcome both of you home. I cannot wait to hear what it is you have composed for my wedding day. I miss you ever so, and wait with all eagerness for your return. Sincerely, Fanny." Felix frantically gathered the letter pile and put them with his other luggage. He decided to read the rest on the way back home. After a quick reorganization, he took his things and raced out the door. The next ship out of London was bound to leave soon. He returned the keys to his landlord, then hurried to the nearest parked gig. He loaded his luggage and hopped on, ordering the coachman, "I must get to the harbor as quickly as possible. The next ship shall leave soon. I cannot miss it." The coachman nodded and made his horse carry on at a fast pace. The horse suddenly became agitated, quickening on its own into a gallop. The coachman tried to slow it, but the horse wouldn't let up. A large coach of four horses was trudging up the street, coming their way. Felix, in fright, snatched the reins from the coachman in an attempt to make their horse turn. It only made the animal lose control, causing the gig to lean towards one side. The whole thing wobbled and tipped after the wheel snapped under the weight. Both the coachman and Felix were thrown from their seats. A blood-curdling scream echoed through the streets.